Cecilia Payne's story begins in a world that wasn't quite ready for her. In early 20th century England, in an era of great discoveries and pondering the mysteries of the universe, the doors for women in astronomy seemed firmly shut.
At the time, it was seen as a very intellectual pursuit, which was very much a man's field. So women's place at the time was generally in the kitchen, more the domestic duties, whereas academia, especially STEM, was really excluded from them. Women weren't allowed to get degrees, weren't even allowed to study in most cases, so it was really a lot of challenges. There was a lot of resistance to women astronomers in UK especially, because their universities and power structures were very traditional. They'd been around for hundreds more years than the US. So there was a lot of fear that allowing women into these spaces would disrupt the power structures. At the time, they really liked the way things were, and any threat to that, such as women allowing into these spaces, really scared people.
Cecilia wasn't one to be bound by the constraints of her time. Fueled by a pioneering spirit, she seized an unexpected opportunity, an invitation from Harvard University's observatory director, Harlow Shapley. In 1923, Cecilia embarked on a journey across the Atlantic to pursue what seemed impossible back home. Harvard was an entirely different world. Unlike Cambridge, women could not only just study astronomy here, but thrive in it. Cecilia, eager and determined, dove into her research.
At the time, it was generally believed that stars were made of the same sort of elements as the Earth's core, so iron, silicon, and more the heavier elements. They genuinely believed that if you heated up the Earth's core to the same temperature as the sun, we would also get the same kind of radiation effects as the sun. So they really didn't think there was a lot of difference except for temperature.
But Cecilia, driven by data from spectroscopy, saw something different. Through months of tedious calculations and analyses, working with her colleagues at the Harvard University Observatory, found that stars mostly contained hydrogen and helium.
So spectroscopy is essentially when you shine a light, usually a white light, through either a prism or a diffraction grating, you're able to split that light into colors. So you can think of it like the Pink Floyd Dark Side of the Moon cover. But when you split light from a sun or a star through that diffraction grating, we're actually going to see black bands or missing bands in that color spectrum or that rainbow. Those bands correspond to the element absorption or emission lines, which we know from quantum physics. So if we are able to match up the bands which we get from stars with the elements, we're able to essentially work out exactly which elements make up the stars. What Cecilia did is she was able to work out that the width of those bands corresponded to the temperature and the amount of each element in the stars. So she was able to work out that our sun was made of about 74% hydrogen and about 24% helium.
It was a discovery that would change astronomy forever. Cecilia had discovered the true nature of the stars and that the most abundant element in the universe was hydrogen. But her groundbreaking work was not yet to be celebrated.
Initially, there was a lot of pushback. Her discovery was seen as just simply unrealistic, not a good measure of what the sun and our universe was made of. Her supervisor, Henry Russell, he actually forced her to add a segment into her PhD thesis, which basically said that I'm publishing this thesis, but I'm aware that these results cannot be true. This is incorrect work. Even though she herself still believed that it was correct and she was very confident in her data. About 4 or 5 years later, Russell did a similar analysis but in a different method, and he was able to actually show the same results. So he published those results. Even though he did credit Cecilia, he was still given pretty much all of the credit for a long while. She had a very, very deep sense of determination. It seemed to really fuel her work especially. She knew the data was there and she knew she was correct in her work, and I think she really leant on that. She's definitely written pages about how the incredible passion and experience it was to being able to be the first person to see this sort of data and make these discoveries. She described it as really invigorating. So I think that really fueled her even through a lot of discrimination. About 10 or 20 years after her thesis was published, other scientists started realizing how incredible it was that she discovered this so early on and with so little support. Nowadays, her thesis is credited by many as the greatest astronomy thesis ever written. Cecilia is revered very highly both by women in the scientific community and the film community in general. She also has a volcano on Venus named after her, which is something I don't think she could have even imagined at the time. She also is considered amongst the likes of Marie Curie and Annie Jumpcannon in her incredible achievements as a woman in science that really persevered against absolutely everyone at the time essentially telling her no. I think if I was Cecilia at the time, we'd all like to think we're also going to be just as determined and persevere the way she did. But in reality, I think it's really hard to know how someone would react in that kind of situation. Nowadays, we have much more refined and better technology to do it. So we use things like the Very Large Telescope, the VLT, or the James Webb Space Telescope, which have spectrographs on it. And it essentially splits those light into absorption bands in a similar way, but we're able to use machine learning tools in order to work out exactly what elements are in the stars rather than doing it by hand. So now we're able to do on the order of thousands every few minutes.
Cecilia Payne Kapochkin would go on to be the first female to head a department at Harvard University, breaking ground for women in science.
I think there is so much we can learn from Cecilia's story and the similar stories of so many women like her at the time that were facing these barriers. These barriers haven't disappeared. Many of them still exist, although they have gotten a lot smaller, thankfully. Cecilia's journey really inspired me to become an astronomer and study the space sciences, despite often not being able to see myself reflected in the so-called greats of science, who were historically mostly men. It made it much easier facing a lot of discrimination and often being the only woman in a room, knowing that there are centuries of women who've been through the same things. And they weren't necessarily the smartest or the most important person in a room either, but they believed in themselves and they knew they had the data and the work to prove it.
Her life was a testament to perseverance, not just one that blazed a trail through the male-dominated world of science, but through the cosmos itself.
I think she'd be really in awe. We have come a really, really long way in some areas, but at the same time, I think she'd recognize there are some parts we haven't come so far. So Cecilia was a very privileged person in England who was able to travel to America to follow her dream and what she was good at. And I think she'd realize that it's still a lot of privilege required to be able to study this nowadays. There's also a lot of rhetoric coming back up that she would unfortunately recognize quite frequently, I think. But overall, I think she'd be absolutely amazed at how far we've come and how many women know her name.
Cecilia Payne Kapochkin wasn't just a scientist. She was a woman who reached for the stars and showed us all that they're within our grasp.